You can get your Bibles out. Let's raise the Word of God high together and say this with me. This is my Bible, God's holy Word. I will make it a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and hide its words in my heart that I may not sin against God. Hey, most of you have that memorized after 18 months. Good job. So today, we're going to talk about why church is important. And I want you to know right now, this quote on the screen is, I want you to hear this loud and clear. You must trust God that right now, you are exactly in the very place God meant you to be right now in this very moment. Maybe somebody invited you and you're here today because they invited you. Maybe you're looking for a church and you just so happened to see our sign and you drove by and you came in here today. Maybe you're what we call C&E Christians. You guys know what they are? Christmas and Easter. So we have now back to church Sunday. So it's Christmas, Easter, and back to church Sunday now. No, on all seriousness, whatever reason you're here, we have to believe right now in this very moment that God has brought us all together in this place for this moment. And I pray that whatever's going on in your life, good, bad, ugly, indifferent, smooth, perfect, maybe some of you are in that perfect moment right now, that you're right here and God wants to speak to you. That's the God that I know, that He wants you to come to Him and draw near to Him. He wants you to hear His voice. He wants you to know that He loves you. He wants to know that He cares about every aspect of your life. The junk in your life and the good things in your life, He wants you to turn them over to Him and let Him be glorified through the things that are going on in you. Now, I can't predict everything, but I want you to know this. No matter who you are and what you're going through, it didn't catch God off guard. Amen. He's already been there. He already knows what you're going to go through. And He's a great high priest that intercedes on our good, on our behalf. You know, when problems happen is when we keep our problems. Troubles happen when we keep our sin and we fail to repent and turn to Him. You know, and in the good times, maybe we get too lackadaisical and comfortable and we forget to praise Him. So when we get in those moments, God is still there no matter whether we realize it or not. And God is always here when we show up. Do you know that? Now we can ignore His presence or we can embrace His presence. And for the time I've been here, what am I asking you to do? Embrace His presence. Whatever that means, to come into a new understanding of what it means to live for God and walk with God and be with God. For most of us, it should take us a journey of life. And if we don't experience it at church, we're not going to experience it at home when things go tough. We're not going to experience when our work and our boss just jumped our case. You know, we're not going to experience it when relationships get difficult, like nobody knows that, right? But if we know that God is there and He's walking with us, it makes it better. And we find that we belong to someone that's greater than us. We belong to the God who created us. And when we do that, we can also come to church and find a place where we belong. So I want you to think about this for a minute. Maybe you've been hurt by church. Nobody's experienced that, right? Maybe you're in here and you can remember something that happened a long time ago, and you're in church today, but you came begrudgingly because of what somebody did to you 10, 15 years ago. Maybe you don't think you need church because you've seen hypocrites. Welcome to church. Amen. Where people don't have their acts all together. Amen. Where we have to learn to be patient with one another and love one another and grow with one another, extend grace and mercy and all kinds of stuff to one another. If we can't get those things right in church, you're not going to get it right in your home. You're not going to get it right at work. You're not going to get it right in your recreational life or anything else. Church is the place where we should be able to come together. When we have things that don't go right, we should be able to work it out together. A place to belong. I want you to think of some things. Maybe some things that you belong to. Maybe there are some organizations and things where you felt, I really belonged. Maybe you feel that way about your family. I really belong in my family. Now, some of you can't experience that, can you? Some of you have broken families. Some of you have families that are like, I don't want to spend Christmas and Easter with them. And that's sad, but I understand those things happen. But some of us, we can belong to family. How about this? Maybe you were on the team sometime in your life and you felt, I really belonged on that team. What did that experience feel like to you? Maybe you're a part of like all of you Navy people, right? Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and Coast Guard, right? You felt like you belonged maybe at some time to that organization, and now you have an Army pastor and you're like feeling very complicated now because you're Navy people, right? But we feel like we belong to a unit. We feel like we belong to a team. And those are, by the way, maybe a fraternity or a sorority. I could give you all kinds of organizations that you might have belonged to in your life, that you felt like you belonged, but none of those can compare to what it's supposed to be like in church. Church is supposed to be the one physical aspect on earth that has an eternal impact. Do you think your fraternity or sorority are going to get you to heaven? Everybody say no. Do you think belonging to the Navy is going to get you to heaven? Everybody, please say no. Army's negotiable, okay? I'm messing with you. And then we're not even going to talk about Air Force, Marines, or Coast Guard, right? But as good as those units might have been in those experiences, church is supposed to be greater than that. And that's what I want to talk about today. And guess what? Paul gives us a picture in Ephesians. I want you to open your Bibles there now. Ephesians chapter 2. Paul's going to start to paint a picture of what the church is supposed to look like. I want to give you a little background on Ephesus first. Ephesus in the first century would have been probably what we would call a mega church today. The church that emerged in Ephesus that Paul is writing about would have been one of the first major hubs where Christians would come together and would worship together. We know from Acts chapter 2 that they probably initially started off by going to the synagogues, and they would have started off in each other's homes. And this would have grown into a place where they would have began to worship together and assemble in a public area to worship God. And Paul starts to paint this picture in chapter 2 as he's communicating with those in Ephesus in verses 19 through 22. Listen to what he's saying to them. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and the members of the household of God. Built on the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the cornerstone, in whom the whole structure being joined together grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you also are being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. May God add a blessing to his holy word. There is freedom. There is hope. There is forgiveness. There is grace. There is mercy. There is love. And there is family in this place. That should define church. So if you've come here today and you need hope, there is hope. There is hope in Christ. If you come and you don't feel loved right now, I want you to know maybe no one in this room has expressed love to you the way you needed it, but I'm telling you there's a God that wants to. Maybe you've come in here today and you know your life is hell. Then there's mercy and there's forgiveness. I'm not here to judge you. I want everybody to hear this loud and clear. I work, and I hope you work at this. I want me to be more offended by my personal sin than the sins of others. Amen. Just because somebody might have what I call a worse sin than me, I need to be more appalled at what sin is in my life than worrying about the sin that's in yours. You need to deal with your sin, and guess what? Jesus did that on the cross. Amen. Your pastor can't do that for you, but Jesus did. No one else can take your sins away but him. So I pray today, if you've come in here and you're saying, I've got all this baggage, would you just give it to Jesus? Begin that process today. Find that hope and that freedom that comes from that. Find a place of refuge and find a place where you can belong. A place that is eternal. So let's break this text down. Everything in this text is surrounded by, it's actually connected to the phrase, in him. All these things are only possible that we're going to talk about today if it's in Christ. So today, if you are not in Christ, or you're like, I don't know what that means, or well, I've always gone to church, I want to define that for you. In Christ means at some time in your life, not through church, not through family, not through any other means, but somewhere in your life, you have made this connection and said, I know what Christ did on the cross and through the empty grave is the gospel, and I accept that. I accept Jesus. I confess that I'm a sinner, and I believe that Jesus has the answer for that, and I want to start to live for him. At that moment, he comes into your life. However that transaction happened, whether it was coming up at an altar call, it was at a youth retreat, or it was just in some quiet moment by your bed where you realized, I'm a sinner and I need Jesus, and I've heard about this Jesus, I accept him. Wherever that happened in your life, if that happened, then you are in Christ. If something like that has not happened, you have not had this personal encounter with the one true God through Jesus Christ, then the first step, and all that I'm going to say today, is you need to have that connection with God through Jesus. So I'm praying for you right now, if you're here and you've not made that connection, that today you will. For all of us that have already made that connection, all these things I'm going to speak of are true of us. Now, when I say they're true of us, they're true that we're supposed to do these things. Now, maybe we're not experiencing all the things that I'm going to talk about today because we're flawed, because church is not perfect, because we are not perfect. But our Messiah, our Savior, the head of this church, Jesus Christ, desires to see us move towards all these things I'm going to speak of. So let's look at this. First, there are three things that are very personal. There are three you are's, and then there's a bunch of we are's. So the you are's are this. You are no longer a stranger or alien. Now, most of us in this room are citizens of the United States of America. We take things for granted. We get the freedom to vote. And if you watch the news, you have the freedom to complain about any politician you want. Right? We have freedoms to be protected by people like you that served in the Navy, in the Army, in the Marines, in the Air Force, in the Coast Guard. We have freedoms to know that we can live our life, and most of the time, except for taxes, the government will leave us alone. We have the right to know that we have a police force, EMTs, and a fire department, that if we dial 911, thank God they're there. Amen? We have so many things that maybe we take for granted, and it's all because we live in the United States of America. Most of us don't have to have a farm. We just go to a grocery store and get whatever we want over the counter, don't we? Food. We do an exchange and we take food. Most of us don't know what it's like to be hungry, to live in true poverty. There are so many blessings that we have. Some of us in here, though, also know this, and I didn't ask this, but I'm just so rejoicing. Sarah. Raise your hand, Sarah. Come on, Sarah. Sarah, 2 weeks ago, became a citizen of the United States of America. She knows what it means to no longer be a stranger, an alien. And guess what? All of us were like Sarah at one time in our lives. We were a stranger to Christ. We were alien to the kingdom of God. We were believing in something of the world, and we were lost, and we didn't even know it. Now look, I know every man in here, you don't like it when your wife says, would you please pull over for instructions? You were lost. And that's where we're grateful. Thank you, GPS. Now, guys, that GPS gets us out of a lot of trouble, doesn't it? Honey, I got this thing. Just let's reset the GPS, man. I am not lost. But a lot of us are running around without a GPS, and we are lost. And we're refusing to stop. At one time, we were that stranger, that alien, that outcast. But God is saying this to the people in Ephesus. You once were a stranger. You once were a foreigner. You once were an alien, but no more. Now you belong to something greater. You belong to me and you belong to a body of believers. The second thing, you are citizens, going right into that, you are citizens with all of God's people, with all the saints. So listen, most of us walk around and we don't think of ourselves as saints. I want you to know if you are a sinner that has repented to Jesus Christ, you're a saint. You don't need the Catholic Church to give your name sainthood. You are a saint. Now we don't look at ourselves that way because I know most of you, we don't act that way, do we? You don't go around calling me Saint Chris. First of all, it is true, but I'm not really a saint as in perfect. We have the wrong view of this. Saint just simply means we become a citizen of the kingdom of God. We are now a child of God. We now belong to God. We now are part of his kingdom. So I want you to think of this. To be a citizen of the United States of America, but Jesus goes beyond that. Do you think Jesus just loves America? No way. He loves the whole world. In fact, it says he has made every boundary to every nation. And he tells us then we are supposed to take the gospel to the ends of the world so that every tribe, every tongue, every language, every earthly kingdom will come to know who? Jesus Christ. That's why I can know in China, if someone knows Jesus Christ, they're a fellow citizen with me in the kingdom of God. If someone from West Virginia believes in Jesus Christ, they're my brother or sister in Christ. If someone from Africa, and I've been corrected by Mary, any of those countries in there, like Nigeria, she's my sister in Christ. Puerto Ricans, my brothers and sisters in Christ, if they're in Christ. So every tribe and every tongue and every land and every nation can be part of the citizenry of the kingdom of God. But Jesus gets more personal here. The church is more personal as Paul's writing to us. It's not just being a citizen. See, we can be a citizen. And by the way, if you watch the news, does Americans hate each other? I don't think it's always been that way, but it seems to be getting worse, in my opinion. And the division is even greater. So God gets more personal. It's not just being a citizen where you can have political views and you can yell at each other and disagree with each other. You actually have to be family and get along. You are members of God's family. Now, I know I have sisters. We didn't always get along, but we always loved each other. I can remember doing some very mean things to them that I cannot tell you what I did here in public, but I'm sure they remember. And somehow they learned to forgive me. That's what we do in the family of God. Amen. So as a family of God, we are no longer aliens, strangers. We become citizens, and then we become part of the family. Each and every one of us, with our differences, with our backgrounds, with our opinions and everything, we're supposed to come together. And then the Bible describes us as becoming one-minded, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one mind, all these ones. Go read the first chapter of Ephesians. We start to become one. So if you become a Christian in Christ, you should start having your mind become more like Christ Jesus. That attitude which is in Christ Jesus should now also be in you. We should start to see the fruit of the Spirit in all of our lives. We should start to be able to identify, I can see the evidence of Christ in you. It's a mystery unto man, but it's not a mystery unto God. That God starts to work in our lives and make us family and make us one. So that is what God wants to see for you, for me. So let's transition here. Before we do that, before we start to realize who we are, I want to read Romans 12, 4, 5. It says, "For we are all one body, we have many members, and those members do not all have the same function. So we, though many, are one body in Christ, and we're individual members of one another." So God has this way of looking at us individually, but looking at us corporately. When God looks down upon us, I want you to hear this, Christ comes for the church. Now, did he die for you individually? Yes, but he died for the bride, which is the church of Jesus Christ. So when God comes back someday, when Jesus returns, will he come back just for you? No, he's coming back for his bride, his church, that's supposed to be ready. So God expects us to work as one unit. He expects us to be a family. Not divided like we see many, many churches or many examples you could give in this day. Where I've told this before, I'm going to tell it again, where I've seen a church that split because a youth ate the last piece of apple pie that was always supposed to be for the chairman of deacons. Chairman of deacons. They can do it to you every time. But I love this guy. He can have the last piece of cherry pie or apple pie. I don't care. All right? But if a youth takes it, I know he's not going to divide the church over it. Amen. But can't we do silly things? So I'm acknowledging to everyone in here, if you're in here, silly things can happen. We get our feelings hurt. Sometimes it's not silly. Sometimes it's serious to us. But we're still family. We work through it. So here are some we are's as he transitions. First of all, we are his house. When we assemble together, we become the house of God. So it's not this building. It's not the brick and mortar and wood and all that goes into the building, although that's nice. We have a nice place we can worship. What's most important is us. We are the body of Christ. We become the house of God. This is the place where he dwells. Does he dwell in each of us individually if we know Jesus? Yes. But he comes into us where two or three are gathered. He is present. Over and over again, he would call us to assemble. Have you ever heard anyone say, I don't need church? Maybe someone you asked this week told you that. I want you to know, and I can only say this because I'm a pastor and I believe in the Word of God, that person's either arrogant or ignorant of what church is supposed to be. And maybe if you've been there, you can confess, at one time I was arrogant. I thought I could do it without the church. Maybe at one time you can just say, I was ignorant. I didn't know any better. I didn't know what the church was supposed to be like. But God is very clear about this. We are his house. We need each other. And he's purposeful about it and saying we need to assemble together. Did you not think that he knew we would have issues? Think of your own life. Do you have issues? Now, Scott might be saying no right now, but I even know Scott has issues, okay? Guess what? And you might say, well, Pastor, you look like you have it together. I have issues. All of us in this room, we're in denial either of arrogance or ignorance if we don't acknowledge the fact that we all need Jesus. And the church is no different. The church takes on its own personality and its own people. This church is much different now than it was 18 months ago. This church will be a lot different 18 months from now than it is today. Because we're going to grow in Christ and we're going to be different. Different people are going to come in. It's going to make it a different family, a different unit. And I think that keeps things exciting and God continues to dwell in his house. We're not alone though. Look what we're built upon. It says we are built upon the apostles and the prophets. So what are they doing? They're telling us everything you've heard, this Bible, the words of the prophets and the old, and now the apostles, as Paul begins to write much of the New Testament, it would become the doctrine. We are built upon the teachings of the prophets and the apostles. This church here, 21 centuries later, we are built upon the teachings of the prophets and the apostles through the Word of God. So we are not left to be ignorant or to be blind. We are given a book to guide us. We're given the very voice of God to speak to our lives. Because we're that important to God. Here's the other thing he does. It says that not only were we built on that foundation, the cornerstone is Jesus Christ himself. In other texts, Paul would go on to say that Jesus is the head of the church, the head of the body of Christ. So that we are not left without a leader. We always have a leader. Listen, God forbid if this ever happens, but I want this church to make a promise to me today. First of all, if I ever die, I want to die preaching. I know that'll freak you out, but if I have to go, I want to be doing what God has called me to do, preach his gospel. So if the Lord wills it, when I'm 99 and I'm still preaching here, and I just fall over, y'all can say, praise Jesus, new pastor time. Or if God calls me somewhere else, which he's not right now, so don't even put bad thoughts in your head, that you all will know you're not leaderless. Jesus is your leader. Jesus is the cornerstone. Jesus is the one that holds all the spiritual building of God together. And when we acknowledge him as the head of our lives, the head of our homes, the head of our church, things start to work the way they're supposed to. And things become a beautiful body of Christ that says we're supposed to be radiant and beautiful, awaiting our Lord to return. That should be the desire of our heart, to know that no matter what, we are not leaderless. We have Christ. We have the teachings of the apostles and the prophets. The next thing I want you to do is we are carefully joined together. Now, I don't know if any of you are in construction or whatnot, but when you get blueprints, there's different people that have different roles to play in building a building. We don't want the carpenters putting in the electrical work. We don't want the electricians putting in the plumbing. We want all the people to do their aspect in the right order to build that building up so that it won't fall down. Well, I saw the building inspectors to come in. If they're supposed to inspect a certain thing, we want them to come in to inspect that. Why? So that we know it was done right and that it's built to code and that if something happens, it can stand and do its job. The same thing is with the body of Christ. It says it's carefully put together. God is building us right now. Now, some of us might have tried to be the electrician instead of the plumber. Jesus is going to try to get you in the right perspective and where you need to be. God is carefully building us to do the things he wants us to do and to be the people he wants us to do. Right now you have people down there during children's church and worship where the kids can learn on something that's more in their atmosphere and more connected to them. Right now we're in here. We had Sunday school going on this morning where people can come together and talk about the word of God and talk to each other about it. Not really conducive right now if you all were asking me 1,000 questions about what I'm talking about. Preaching's different than the teaching that takes place. So we all are being fit together and have to believe that God is calling us all to do our part, and he's carefully building us up to be the body of Christ he wants us to be. Is that positive? Yes. Where things get negative in a church, and I'm sorry if you've ever been hurt, is because people aren't viewing God building his church. They think it's their church. Amen? I've seen people where they think, that's my pew, that's my seat. Why did you sit in my seat, Enable? You know, why are you, and I'm telling you, I've seen this. This turf in here belongs to all of us because it's given to us from Christ. So when we realize that it's God that's building us up, that we all have a role to play with, the church becomes much healthier. And in the Bible, it says we become a holy temple. The temple was what? The place where God's presence dwelt. That's Old Testament. Well, Jesus came, and it says when he died, the veil was ripped from the top to the bottom, opening up the Holy of Holies, where only the high priest could ever enter, because Jesus made a way for us to directly come to him. And Jesus made a way for his spirit, his presence, to come into our lives through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, so we become the temple. And when we gather together, that's all of us, the temple of God, coming together to worship God in splendor of his holiness. The last one is, it says, we are the dwelling place where God lives by his Spirit. I think a lot of Baptists are afraid of the Holy Spirit. I've talked about this a lot. We've really got to unleash the Holy Spirit and stop putting limits on what God can and can't do. We don't need to be afraid. As long as if we get a little charismatic, it's biblical, then it's okay. Amen. I got one amen. The Holy Spirit is not to be confined. He's to be unleashed. And it's a he, not a it. It is the very presence of God working in your life. He should be convicting you, challenging you, encouraging you. All kinds of things that he has to roll to speak to your life. He is a helper in your life and my life. And the Holy Spirit in the presence of God, when you come in here, he does things that only he can do that we can't do. Like save somebody. Like convict someone of their sin. I could tell you about your sin, you could tell me about my sin, but until the Holy Spirit convicts me, it's not going to do any good. It's not going to do you any good. But when God gets involved and starts moving, look out. And when people come with seriousness expecting God to show up each week, look out. I think some of us go through the motions. You ever gone through the motions? I just got to go to church because I got to go to church. My parents make me go to church. Or maybe you were just raised and I just knew to go to church. All right, I'm glad you're here, but I want you to come with some expectancy. I actually expect God to do something in my life today because I'm here. If God's in me, I should expect him to be stirring things up in my life. And if God is in this church, I should expect him to be here and doing things in the life of the church, and there should be evidence of that. I need church, and so do you. Now, I know you're saying, you're the pastor, you get paid to say that. I say that because I believe that. I say that, and I left a secular world where I could make much more money than I make here. Not that I don't say you're not taking care of me. Because I believe in what I believe. Because I believe that the church is the difference maker in the world. And I believe that you are God's answer to the world. That's kind of messed up, isn't it, you guys? Jesus is depending on us. Now, some of us don't think, no, God's sovereign. He's got it all. Yes, he does, but his sovereignty, he chose the church. Jesus chose the church. That's biblical, you guys. That doesn't take away that God can do anything he wants to do. God can do anything he wants to do, and he's chosen to do it through his church. We are the presence of Christ in the end days until he comes back. The church is how he chose to reveal himself to the world. That's you and me. Are we taking that serious enough, and are we doing it? Listen to what Ephesians 5:25 says. Just as Christ also loved the church, he gave himself up for her. If you've been in any type of marital counseling with me, I run the Ephesians chapter 5. This whole chapter is actually talking about a husband and a wife. But when it gets to the end, he compares what the way the man's supposed to love the wife. He starts to compare that to what Jesus did. And in here in Ephesians 5:25, he says that Jesus gave himself up for the church. He died for the church. We know in Romans 5:8 that God demonstrated his love for us in this way, that while we were yet sinning, Christ died for us. So over and over again, the scripture compels us to understand that Jesus died for his church, that Jesus came to make us a radiant bride ready to receive him. So as you seek in your life a place to belong, maybe you're looking for a church today. Maybe you've not found a place to belong. Maybe you're even in here and you're just going through the motions. Maybe you're in here and you know, you've heard me time and week after week say, if you're not a member of the church, why aren't you? Come up and join the church. Become part of something that's bigger than yourself. But there'll still be some say, I don't need membership. You ever heard that too? Maybe you've never been baptized. Maybe you're a believer in Jesus Christ and you've never followed through with believer's baptism. Today's your day to do that. If you want to get baptized today, I'll take you down to the river when we go do Reagan here in just a little bit. And then Aniba will make sure there's no jellyfish or snakes in there for you. But if you need to do a transaction with God, he's here. He's in this place. Now you can blow him off today or you can surrender to him today. Maybe you're in here today and you're struggling. You're struggling with something in your life. I'm not your high priest. You don't have to confess that to me. But you should do that with God. You should make a commitment to him today. God, I want to be right with you. Maybe you need to rededicate your life. Maybe you need to come to receive Jesus for the first time. But I assure you these things. I wrote down 5 principles. If you find that this is the place that you belong in church, then you need to be assured that God has done this. He has created a church to be made up of his people. That's you and me. He's created a church that is supposed to be about his purposes, which is taking the gospel to the ends of the earth. He has created a church that's supposed to live by godly principles, which is by the teachings of the apostles and the prophets and the holy word of God. And he has created a place that's supposed to be powered by his Holy Spirit. And lastly, he has created a place with you in mind. Have you let those things be true in your life? Have you found a place where you come together with people as family? Have you found a place where you truly have purpose in life? Where you have principles you can live by? Why you are empowered by a power greater than you, the Holy Spirit, and where you can belong? If you have, welcome to Lexington Park Baptist Church. If you haven't discovered that today, I pray that today will be the first step in your journey. But more importantly, or maybe not more importantly, but something I want to say, the most important thing for me is, I'm glad that you came today. And then I'm glad you're here because like that first slide I showed, this is exactly where God wanted you to be today. So ask yourself one question. Why did God call me here? And then secondly, what does he want me to do about it? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, in this final moments, as we close, may you draw your people close to you. May you speak to them. If someone needs salvation, I pray, God, I can't say anything clearer than I have today. It's got to be you doing it. Father, I pray right now in these moments that if people are looking for a place to belong, that they'll realize that you have them here today, and this is where you've called them to. Father, I pray for any decisions that made, they will honor you, and they will come forward for you. And you alone. I pray also for everyone in their seats today. God, just bless their lives. Just be with them. Let them know how important they are to you. Let them sense your love and your presence right now. And may they respond to you as you lead them. These are the prayers that I lift to you in Jesus' name. Amen.